Ladies and gentlemen, our final presentation prior to lunch comes from Julian Carroll. Julian's a fourth generation farmer from Mudgeegonga in Victoria. Carroll family's involvement in Angus dates back to the 1930s, and on their property Round Hill, they now run a self-replacing spring calving herd with 350 breeders. Only last month, Julian and two other beef producers from the Oven Valley made a trip to Canberra to meet with MPs, advisers and senators to discuss the progress and their concerns about recent Senate inquiries into the Australian beef industry. Julian has also taken the opportunity to upgrade his skills on farm by undertaking training through the More Beef from Pastures programs. So I'm truly interested to hear from a local landholder who has had such a long-running interest in the beef industry and that we hope will continue to do so for a long time. Please welcome Julian.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here to talk about our family beef enterprise, something I'm very passionate and very proud of. Jen mentioned that our involvement with Angus goes back to the 30s. Parts of our farm go back to the 1870s when my great-grandfather bought some of, or originally selected some of it. Our only conundrum is whether we are still called Round Hill. We actually sold the paddock that had the Round Hill in it, so it's a bit awkward. I moved home in 2008 after 20 years in Melbourne working in IT. And I think it's very fortunate that the timing of my return coincided with Dad showing a bit more willingness to loosen the reins and let the next generation have a go. And I say next generation because it's not just me. I've got two very highly skilled brothers that provide a fountain of valuable advice, and one of which is involved in the business for leasing some extra land that we do. So the opportunity for change prompted me to review everything we were doing on the farm and really explore what is the best practice for the sort of enterprise we wanted to run. And I think this feat was easier and far more achievable with the fresh eyes that I was able to bring back. And I think that's the reason I'm here today, is because I found a lot of value in many of the resources and principles covered in the Better Beef group. I'm actually accused of being a teacher's pet because I've implemented quite a lot of them too. Anyway, I'll tell you about the business. So, combined over three properties, some of which is leased, we're working with 510 hectares. About half of it is very high quality country, loam on red clay, and about the other half is lighter granitic soils. It's a really useful mix for us, having the good finishing country and the good cow country on the lighter soils. Predominantly ryegrass, clover and annual weeds, and the lease block got a good sound of phalaris, which has inspired us to look at how we can clean up our pastures a bit better. I actually made this farm calendar for my city-based siblings so that in the hope that maybe their farm visits might coincide with a little farm work, but that might have been a bit optimistic of me. Regardless, it provides a good overview of our program. As mentioned, we're spring calving. So we start pretty much, well, our due dates are the 8th of August, so we've had a couple of twins already because they often come a bit early. So the bulls go out for a 6-week joining at the end of October. We preg test as early as weather permits in February and wean calves based on a few different factors, and I'll talk about that a bit later on. We've got a pretty regimented husbandry regime with blanket drenching in the winter on all of the growing animals, and drenching the calves at weaning. Our marketing is fairly regimented as well. We retain our steers and sell them into the EU program, and we aim for two sales. So basically the first B-double goes at the end of November or early December, as long as it's before Christmas, and the tail end in the first 2 weeks of January. We also have a spring and an autumn turnoff of everything else, and they go into the value-added grass-fed markets, which I'll talk a bit more about as well. We've got a fairly modest pasture renovation program where we're really just trying to get the biggest bang for our buck out of our pastures with the most potential. So that involves sowing and silage as part of that program. So spring calving. We changed from autumn calving to spring calving in 2009. And really the main reason is to align that peak lactation period with the big hump in our pasture growth. When we were autumn calving, we had that lactation back on that smaller hump, and then we'd have to feed all the way through the dip in winter and have the excess pasture in the spring, which we then had to use phytoconservation to utilise and also set us up for the following winter. This blue line is our calculated stocking rate, and this is a great tool I picked up from the Better Beef Group through the Evergraze product. It shows what's happening with our stocking rate from a month to month, and you can see that in the spring, as our cows are lactating and the calves are growing, our stocking rate goes up. And that's also being driven by the steers that we're finishing and the retained heifers. Across January, February, March, it's fairly flat as things dry off. The big jump from December back to January is occurring because we sell all the steers then. The big jump, the big dip from March in during April is when the cows dry off and when we sell any excess females that are not pregnant. By growing out our steers, we naturally increase our stocking rate, and that, as I said, maximises our feed utilisation in the spring. Using the cattle to eat the grass rather than the tractors and mowers is far more cost effective, and driving, keeping our costs low is one of the main drivers for the changes we've implemented. So why does spring calving work for us? There's a number of benefits from aligning the nutritional requirements to the feed availability. And the most obvious of these is not having to feed cows. This took some getting used to. Feeding cows was something Dad and all of our neighbours seemed to have done all of their lives. But having a lease block where it was physically impossible to feed cattle sort of reaffirmed that we were on the right track and that it was possible. The next obvious thing is we don't have to make hay, and that's obviously a big cost to our activity. We still make a little bit of silage with our pasture innovation program, and we use that for weaning calves in the autumn. We have less exposure to grass tetany. Dad often tells horror stories of losing a dozen cows in a day when we were autumn calving. Grass tetany risk is highest for old cows lactating through the winter. Grass tetany was also one of the reasons we still thought we might need hay in our system, but we've had good success with loose lick supplements, and we've fairly much eliminated grass tetany from our mature cow herd. We found the loose lick supplements to be far more effective than hay and cosmag. Getting cows pregnant in the spring is really easy. We've tightened our calving timeframe to 6 weeks and getting a very predictable pregnancy rate. And as already touched on, getting efficient pasture utilisation by growing our steers out to the feedlot spec and having them off at the end of spring. This is a description of our breeding herd, which is quite young. Our oldest cows are calving at 5 or 6. That age depends on how we're going with pregnancy rates and deciding to cull for other factors. The 6-week joining I touched on, and we join a fairly high rate of heifers, 75%. It's not all, but it's just weeding out the low performers and anything with bad temperament. So more than half the herd is 2 or 3 year old, and there's only a third of the herd that's older than 4. What's so good about young cows? People often ask me this. Firstly, for us, we're looking to value add at every single opportunity, and heifers are always the lowest value animal to market. Cows always seem to be in a good sellable condition, and they always seem to be making good money, especially lately. The young herd puts increased selection pressure and faster genetic gain. One of the key EBVs that we try and pursue is balancing all things, but is our 400-day growth EBV, which reflects when we're trying to turn off our cattle. The more we can get the cattle away, or the sooner we can get the cattle away, or the more we can get off before Christmas, is a huge driver for our profitability. Already touched on the fact that the younger cows have a lower risk of grass tetany. And joining a lot of heifers reduces our exposure to fertility disasters. Things like bulls breaking down or disease like Vibrio or something like that. I also think we are pretty much mitigating against any risk or any cost. I'm not seeing any cost from pestivirus. I know we have pestivirus. We auto-vaccinate by running known PIs with our heifers and pull them out a few months before joining. Having a predictable conception rate and having plenty of joined animals sort of eliminates the cost of decreased fertility associated with pestivirus for us. If we do have a disaster, we haven't had one yet, we simply just keep our middle-aged cows on for another year. This is what Dad always tells me, but old cows raise the best calves. That's not just Dad. And it's true, old cows wean heavier calves. It's only relevant if you're selling weaners, and we don't. As mentioned earlier, growing out the calves in our system is a really important cog in our system for our efficient pasture utilisation. We're again and adding value to the animals we're selling by growing them out. Now, I knew you wouldn't be satisfied with that, so I've dug up some data to prove it. This is looking at the steers whose mothers age on you based on their tagging at 14 and 15 months. And what we can see here is the red dots are three-year-old cows, or calves, steers from three-year-old cows. The green dots are from the older cows, and the blue dots are from the heifers. And you have to look very hard to see that there's any real advantage going to older cattle. Here's the same data, just spread out in one big long linear fashion, and you were certainly not seeing that heifers' calves are stacked down the bottom end. So I also had a look at the data for the steers that we've sold for the last 4 years into the EU job. As we've heard earlier, we have no control over markets, and we can see price per kilogram fluctuating up and down. Seasonal constraints we don't have a lot of control over, so again we're seeing our average weights fluctuating up and down. Price per head is a function of those two, and you can see that in 2013 with low prices and low weights, we had a lower price per head. But what we've done to kind of balance this out is make sure we put we're carrying as many stock as we can that our system can afford. And that sort of leads into this most important graph for Arch, which is maintaining a high rate or an upward trajectory of our total kilograms of turnoff. We can see that in 2013 we would have had a pretty bad year with low prices and low weights, but because we had the upward pressure, we didn't take too big a hit for our turnoff in terms of dollars. I think looking at this data just helps us to think less about what we're selling our animals for on a per head basis or per cents per kilo basis, and just think about maximising the things we can control and maximising the kilograms of beef we're turning off. So that's the steers. The females, again, seeking value-add markets. We've been tending to sell into JBS in Melbourne for the Farm Assured program, which the consumers would know as Great Southern, as in the supermarket or the eaters, although most of it is exported. Assuming we can make a truckload, that is, then the cost of the freight down to Melbourne as opposed to sending them to Wodonga is generally still less than the extra money on offer for the animals going into this Farm Assured program. Initially, the good money was for the animals that were grading MSA, the young animals, but in recent times, now the mature cows are also getting a premium. I'm sure Mark will talk more about the program later. I find it really exciting that we're seeing our cattle go into, again, another value-added strain, and that in the, you know, with the fast food service, the fast food restaurants in the US that are buying grass-fed beef, you know, are really calling out for a premium product, and I'm glad that ours is going that way and not just in with the rest of the commodity items. When and what are we selling in? Oh, we're missing some data there. In the autumn, we're selling unjoined heifers. We're selling anything that's empty, and we're selling steers that went over spec back in December. They were too heavy before Christmas. In the spring, we're selling any cows that didn't raise a calf, and any of the tail end of the steers that might have had pink eye or warts at the time or been underweight. Along the journey, we're also checking for any other ways to get cattle off earlier. So, for example, sending export heifers to China if we can get a premium. And this year we had a bit of a dabble with Auctions Plus. We put our tail end of the heifers up on Auctions Plus. And interestingly, we didn't get our reserve, but that almost demonstrates the real value of Auctions Plus, I think, because, you know, we get to put them back in the paddock. I like to think of weaning as the biggest pressure valve in our system. In our herd, weaning alone drops our stocking rate by nearly 25%. The lactating cow and calf are running at 26 DSE, and once we take the lactation out of the equation, the two animals combined and they make up 20 DSE. The stocking rate drops even further when you factor in the empty cows that are, and the surplus cows that are leaving the farm at this time. The timing of early of weaning. We'll wean early when the condition score drops below 3. That's a photo of the cows back in April. The ones that we can see side on are the older cows. The one staring us down the barrel is a bit ribby. She's a younger cow. It's something I'll work on next year is potentially weaning the younger cows a bit sooner. Typically, we would wean in mid-April when the calves are 6 to 7 months. And for those of us that are doing performance recording, that's when we get to that 200-day age. We will leave them on later under certain circumstances, maybe a failed autumn break if the cows have got fat, but we don't have grass in the paddocks for the calves. But I guess having the options of that period in the autumn, depending on what's happening with the season, it's a really probably a most important tool that we can access. Champions of spring calving would point out that we should just wean earlier because lactation is a bit inefficient, it's quite inefficient. But for us, we're balancing that with trying to minimise our fodder conservation and doing the least possible amount of feeding. I also think our cows get way too fat. So our process is to yard wean, well, sort of. It's about 300 calves in a 2-acre paddock. They're fed very high quality silage. The silage is essentially a planted winter cleanup crop, generally quite a fancy blend of latest release ryegrasses and clovers. And we basically feed them till the silage runs out, which is generally about a month. This counters the shock of weaning and sets their rumens up, sets them up for the winter. It also teaches them to love humans, which is a very important part. They tend to look a little bit athletic by the end of winter, but they, looking at them yesterday, they still look pretty good. It may not be as low as 1/4 kilo a day, but I think as long as they're maintaining and holding for that short period in the middle of winter, we're not seeing too big a cost. We typically see a fairly flat growth through winter and very fast growth in our spring flush. Last year we had a cracking autumn, so we saw really good performance all the way through. We got the first speed double away 3 weeks earlier last year as a result of that good season. Feed testing is really important for us. We really need to know that we're meeting the energy and protein requirements, especially in the dry autumn when the feed value in the paddocks is so poor, and especially when they're in the yard scenario where we're making up 70 to 80% of their diet. It's also essential in allowing us to calculate a feed budget. I don't think you'll be able to see much there, but this is just a snapshot of what the tool looks like. This is another great thing I've learned from the BetterBeef group, where I can, from this, see that I need to feed a certain quantity, which is I think 3.5 or 4 bales of silage every day while they're in the yard process, but I can drop that back to 2 bales a day when they go out in the paddock and the supplementary feed is only 30% of their diet. This is essential for us because if we need to buy feed, we need to We need to know how much what quality of feed we're buying based on what the quality of what we've got and the quality of what's in the paddock. So that's it in a nutshell. And what's ahead? We'll continue to work on our pastures and fertility. We soil test every paddock so that we can really customise the applications of fertiliser and lime on a paddock-by-paddock basis. We're starting to use more strategic applications of nitrogen in the winter, which we haven't done in the past, and gibberellic acid, where we think we'll get a good response. looking at keeping our eye always on other forms of marketing. An agent that we do a bit of work with is trying something new, which is exciting, which is putting together an auction for feedlot steers on a forward contract basis. So marketing the steers this August, and as a producer you get to say when you would deliver them, set a reserve and see how you go. Again, one of the most important things about auctions plus is that this is something we can try now. If we don't meet our reserve, then we'll just stick to what we do traditionally, and the cost of passing the cattle in isn't that high. They're still on the farm. I really want to think more about pestivirus. As I said earlier, I'm really not seeing a cost to our business in our model by retaining so many heifers. Whether we are selling a heifer at 18 months that was never joined or preg tested empty makes no difference to us. But again, I'll look into that with a bit more detail. Perhaps I can join heifers for shorter, perhaps a 4-week joining, get an extra 2 weeks into the average age of our calf. And extra kilos as a consequence. The other thing I'll look at is a bit more aggressive earlier weaning for the heifers, weaning the heifers because their condition score drops below 3 quicker than the cows do, and so I'm often thinking, well, I'll wean now because the heifers look terrible, but I don't want to wean now because the cows are still fat. So next week I might do them earlier. Next year we'll do them earlier. Another great idea I got from my BetterBeef group from one of the other growers was to PT at preg testing, get rid of those empty cows on the spot and let their calves wean themselves with the main mold rather than carry them through in that last phase of inefficient production. I think that's me. Thank you very much for hearing me out, and good luck for what's looking to be an exciting year for beef.